So we're going to do a little reclaiming of Christmas today was sort of what was rumbling through me this week. And we start with the image, a very classical image of Christmas, because Christmas is that wonderful time when we do get to remember that God came to earth in human form. It is that sparkling, absolutely different time of year when we have a real awareness that what we're celebrating is the miracle, the amazing miracle of God coming to earth in human form. He comes as light of the world. But if you're at all like me, often that precious message, that awareness, gets covered over with a gazillion different things, from presents and decorations and stresses of life, family pressures that happen, oh my goodness, the whole month, parties that happen, expectations that happen, what am I going to give to somebody, who's going to come, what am I going to wear, all this stuff seems to happen, and it just covers up that wonderful focus, that wonderful heart and soul of Christmas. So what I'd like to do today is strip away some of that, some of those pieces, and reclaim for all of us, I hope, a little bit more of the actual mystery and marvelous, amazing fact and reality of Christmas, and to use St. Nicholas as a help in order to do that. St. Nicholas's feast day is December the 6th, which is coming up this week. He died on December the 6th in 343. And as our own very own St. Nicholas mentioned, so much of what we encounter today in Santa Claus actually has its roots back in St. Nicholas and his wonderful story. So I want to be able to tell you a little bit as we go through this time together, a little bit about St. Nicholas and who he is. As I say, he was born in about 280 AD, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And he had a very rich and very full life. And a lot of wonderful stories generated around him, and he became extremely popular as a saint after his death. As the time went on, though, as the Reformation hit and the importance of the saints lessened, the power of St. Nicholas still remained. His story was still so strong. His deeds of kindness had just radiated through so many people, and his stories around gift-giving had been so strong that he reappeared in other ways after the Reformation. He reappeared as Kris Kringle, as Père Noël, as Father Christmas, and as Sinterklaas. Do we have some of those floating by up there? All those different images. And in about the 1700s, the Dutch immigrants brought Sinterklaas over to North America, to America, to New Amsterdam. And they brought their traditions of going along with St. Nicholas and the gift-giving over to America with them. Well, we know the story of what happened after once Sinterklaas landed in America. He got morphed again. And in the 1900s, stories were written about him, and his caricature began to change a little bit. And then we hit the later on into the 1900s, and Coca-Cola got into the business, and we changed him again. He began to look like this. This is still St. Nicholas, right? He's just been morphed and rewritten as the culture goes on. And then we end up with the kind of Santa Claus that we have today. The name changed from Sinterklaas to Santa Claus in the 1800s. And the Santa Claus that we have today and that our children wait for today to have gifts brought by Santa Claus, the origin, truly, it traces right back to St. Nicholas in 280 AD. It's really quite a fascinating story to hear that the sorrow, I think, is that the image and the picture of Santa Claus has become so enormous that it's overlaid the wonderful image of Jesus coming into the world, of God coming into the world, that St. Nicholas was honoring and living out in his life. So what I would really love to do today is not replace Santa Claus with St. Nicholas. I'm not sort of thinking that way. It's much more releasing, using St. Nicholas as a way of releasing Jesus, so that Jesus again is the focus for the season. St. Nicholas would never want to be the focus for the season. That wasn't what he was about. He was about kindness and compassion and helping people, and much of what he did in secret. So it's not about switching Santa Claus to St. Nick. It is about refocusing ourselves so that Jesus is our focus. So a tiny little bit first just about St. Nicholas and who he was and what he was like. He lived actually in what we call Turkey today, in the southwestern part of Turkey. He was born into a wealthy family, but his parents died when they were very young, and so he was orphaned. He had a great faith in God from the time he was a young one, and he lived out his faith in a very real and tangible way. So when he was left with money, his tendency was to give money away. And the stories that abound around St. Nicholas are all about his kindness, his compassion, and his service to others. The history would say that he started orphanages for children who were alone like he was. He started hospitals to care for the sick. He started hostels for the mentally ill. When a famine struck the land, he organized food to go out to people. When people were imprisoned unjustly, he worked to relieve them. His focus seemed to be so often around tiny children who were hurting, and the other emphasis goes to people at sea. He came from the south of Turkey, of Portland, and so he had an emphasis too on sailors. That the thing I think about St. Nicholas was that he lived the gospel message. There's that old expression that preach the gospel every day, use words only when necessary. Well, St. Nicholas was one of those ones who lived the gospel. What Connie read to us from 1 John about God being love, that's what St. Nicholas was. And people experienced through him an incredibly deep compassion and sense of love. And that was one of the things that seemed to just move through his life that made something, that there was something special about St. Nicholas. So after he died, the stories about him continued. And they were nurtured and carried by the people of faith. And you know in the history that saints are people that people prayed to in those days. And they would find that when they would pray to St. Nicholas after he had died, things would still happen. Marvelous things would happen. So all sorts of stories began to grow up around St. Nicholas. He died in 343, and the stories continued to carry on about what this exceptional man was like. By 450 AD, they were building churches and naming them St. Nicholas churches. As the centuries went on and we hit sort of 1000 AD and 1200 AD, his popularity continued. And like there were a lot of saints that the church collected over those centuries, but St. Nicholas was head and shoulders above all the rest. By the time we hit sort of 1000 AD, when the Roman Catholic Church and the Orthodox Church are kind of going their separate ways, St. Nicholas is the key saint of all saints. He's second only to the Virgin Mary. Second only. There are over 2,000 churches and chapels that have been dedicated to St. Nicholas. There was something about this man that grabbed people's attention, that made them hold these stories about him and treasure them as they went on. Today we would say he was a household name. Today we would say St. Nicholas is a rock star. That's the kind of way that he was seen and experienced in the church over those first 1,000 years. So I enjoyed my week pondering St. Nicholas, and a couple lessons began to settle in for me that I'd love to share, will share with you, that came out of his life for me. And the first is that we often find ourselves saying that we're living in a turbulent world. And if you're in church land at all, that the church is in a turbulent place, a place of transition and change. I'm over 60, and the church sure isn't like what it was like when I was a child. It's not like what it was 40 years ago or even 30 years ago. The church is in a time of change. It reflects the enormous change going on in the world beyond church. When I read St. Nicholas, he lived in a stunning time. It amazed me. He was born in 280 AD, like just 150 years after Jesus. I'm your breath away. And it was a time of persecution. And when he died in 343, this persecuted, cultish kind of church had become a state religion. talk about the transition and change that this man experienced in his life. As a young boy, he grew up in a church that was organic, was growing, was searching, trying to figure out who they were. They had no canon of scripture. They had no Bible that they held up solid. These are the verses. This is what we're going to follow. They were still figuring that out. They had no liturgy that they came into with robes and the same thing every Sunday morning. They had none of that. They were contesting theology and fighting about all sorts of issues. We'll pick that up in a moment. When St. Nicholas was born, the church was under persecution. One of the Roman emperors said, "You must worship me as a god, and if you didn't, you'd be imprisoned." Well, Nicholas was imprisoned. He spent 5 years in prison, and it wasn't a single cell for his faith. It was a turbulent time. It didn't have form and structure and a solid core of what was going on. But what it had was realness. It wasn't a homogeneous church that everybody believes the same thing. We'll check off all the boxes and this is what we believe. It wasn't like that. But what it had was realness and vitality and energy. Because to become a Christian, you had to make a solid step. You had to declare who you were. And you might be imprisoned for your faith. You might die for your faith. It was a significant step. It wasn't clean and neat and tidy and everybody believing, but it was alive and it was real and it was life-changing. And that was the world that Nicholas was born into. 313 comes along. He's a bishop by this time. Constantine is now an emperor of Rome, and he declares that this persecuted cult is now the state religion. Ha! Things have to start to change at this point in time. Order has to come. Things are switched all around about. So I began to ponder this whole, is there something from Nicholas's life that you and I can learn from and grow in? He lived in a time of deep challenge. How do we do in the midst of challenge? When our church, when our world is changing, how do we stand? When our church is changing, how do we stand in the midst of challenge? It's nothing new. Generations before us have gone through transition and change. How will we stand in the midst of it? One bit of help I find in this comes from the next lesson I'd share with you from Nicholas. I always ask these two questions, at least they're common for me. What do we believe, and what difference does it make that we believe that? So I go to Nicholas, and what did he believe? Well, in the stories of him, we have one story that's kind of intriguing around what he believed. After Constantine came along and the church had to be organized, they started to have councils in order to organize the church, organizational meetings. And one of them took place in the north of Turkey called the Council of Nicaea. And they gathered all the bishops together there, and they did some organizing into this state religion thing. They did some work on the creed. And because what was going on at that time was that there was a big debate about who Jesus is anyway. The debate sort of centered on, was there one God or was there a Trinity? Which way did it fall? Was Jesus the same as God or was he similar to God? Was he created by God, so he's similar, or was he the exact same as God, always existing? And they had huge arguments and debate. The theology wasn't firm and clear. But what happened at that council? Now, we don't know 100% for sure that Nicholas was there. He's listed in some of the documents of that council, but not them all. But it would make sense that he was there. It was in Turkey. It wasn't far from where he was living. It's in the north of his what we know as Turkey. And he was a bishop. And a popular bishop, a well-known and popular bishop. And all the bishops were called up to the Council of Nicaea. The story is that at that council, Nicholas took a firm stand. He stood against Arius, who was proclaiming that Jesus was similar to God, not the same of God. And he stood up boldly to Arius and said, "No. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the same as God. Jesus is the very God of very God. just what we have in the Nicene Creed. And with his stand, it helped turn the tide and helped declare that that was how we, the church, would see Jesus as totally divine, as the same nature of God.
The story is that he bopped the fellow on the face and knocked him over, and he got defrocked for misbehaving, but then they saw Mary and Jesus all around Nicholas, and so they brought him back in as a bishop and made him a bishop. That piece I don't know. There are tons of fanciful stories around Nicholas too,
but the story is that he took a stand on who he saw Jesus to be, who he knew Jesus to be, and it was Jesus as the Son of God. So that whole piece comes, who's Jesus for you and for me? And I think a part of reclaiming Christmas for ourselves is to reclaim who Jesus is. Now, it may be crystal clear to you who Jesus is, and that's good. It may be that you're in a searching, wondering, questioning place around who Jesus is. And you know, I'd say that's okay too. It may be that you're in a place where you're wondering about who Jesus is, that he's changing for you. And I would say that that's okay too. It's less having a dotted line that this is the way and it always will be and it never will change. What is important is that we relate to Jesus. We know him, we know who he is, and that we have a relationship with him. And as in any relationship, our knowledge of him will grow and change over the time. Our awareness of his presence and of his divinity will grow and change over the time. Our awareness of the mystery of who Jesus is, far beyond we can ever comprehend, will grow and change over time. The focus is to know him and to know who he is. Hugh and I had dinner on Friday night with a couple who've been married over 50 years, and the wife was telling a story about her mother. And the husband was listening to this story, and he says to her, "You know, I have never heard that story before." They've been together 50 plus years, and he was learning something new about his wife and something new about her family. He was seeing her in a different way. And so it is with our relationship with God, that we are to know God and know Jesus, and yet we are to grow and change over time as we get to know him better and better and better. The main thing is, who is Jesus for you? Do you know who he is? Can you put words to who he is? That's the truth that Nicholas stood on. And for us to stand as we reclaim Christmas, it's that time to focus on Jesus. Who is he for you? How do you describe him? But the last piece that I found from Nicholas is around justice. It's one thing to say who Jesus is. It's a whole nother thing to let who Jesus is begin to change your heart and begin to change your life so that you live differently. And that's the big piece of getting to know him. The story that's told around St. Nick, that's kind of a classic St. Nicholas story, is that there was a dad with three daughters, and he couldn't afford a dowry for them, and so he was going to sell them into prostitution in order to care for the family. Nicholas got wind of this, and he secretly dropped three bags of gold into the man's house on different nights, one for each daughter, so that they would not be sold into prostitution, but that they could have a proper marriage and a proper life. It was done quietly, it was done generously, and with much compassion. It's believed that that's most possibly a true story from St. Nicholas's time, for a number of reasons. One is that it would not have been a popular thing to do, to save women. That the women were not highly regarded in the culture, and so to create an action which saves women would be unusual for them. And it also is that in the Christian church, women were honored and were respected. So what kind of makes sense, that story? Plus, there's no great miracle that's attached to it. It's a simple act of secret kindness and secret generosity. And it's out of that story of with the three girls that the giving of gifts to children comes, and that the giving of gifts in the nighttime comes, that there's somebody coming while you sleep that's going to give you a gift. That's the origin of it, in that story of St. Nicholas giving that gift to those three girls. So I found in there that touching piece for St. Nicholas, He allowed people's pain to touch his heart. And he sculpted his life out of that kind of pain. He even allowed his money to follow his heart. There's a great expression from Dave Toyson, was the first I heard it. Let your heart be broken by the things that break the heart of God. Let your heart be broken by the things that break the heart of God. Jesus came into this world out of the broken heart of God. Jesus came because you and I hurt. He came because we're not good, we're not perfect, but we hurt one another and we do harmful things. That's why Jesus came, to give us a whole new way of being, to give us a new heart with his spirit embedded within us. Another phrase I came across somewhere was, a whole heart is a broken heart. If we are to live wholeheartedly in our lives, we need to allow our heart to be broken by the world, to be touched by the pain and the suffering of the world. And I was most struck this week, most reminded this week, that the issue that broke Nicholas's heart in that story of girls being sold into prostitution is still with us today. Girl babies are aborted faster than boy babies. Girl babies are abandoned at a far higher rate than boy babies. Look at the demographics of what's happened in China since they went to the one child only, and the unequal balance that's there now between men and women in the coming generation. Girls are still kidnapped and taken into sex trafficking today. They're still imprisoned in slavery today. The issue hasn't gone away. I gave a couple of slides up there for Derwin to run of just what International Justice Mission is, one that I've sponsored for years, that deals with sex trafficking, of prosecuting people who are engaged in sexual slavery. The one from Matty Nepal, Koikala, was a CNN hero of last year, of rescuing girls from the sex trade in Nepal. They're kidnapped in Nepal and taken to the brothels in India, and she's rescued over 12,000 of them. Children of the Night is an organization run by Dr. Lois Lee in America, in the United States of America, where to rescue teen prostitutes from the street. Rugmark, the last one I put up there, deals with child slavery. These issues are still here with us today. And I guess the question that I'd ask is, if we allowed our heart to be broken by the heart of, whereas God's heart is broken, how would it shape our lives? And where would our money go? If we allow our hearts to be broken by the things that break the heart of God, where would our money go? Maybe another way to reclaim Christmas is in our gift giving, is more charitable gift giving to places that speak to issues that are on your heart and to make a difference. Maybe not another bottle of scotch or an electronic toy, or as the ad on the radio goes, a pair of socks, but to give a chicken or a goat or water to a village, or help for girls in the sex trafficking trade. It is for us to reclaim Christmas so that Jesus and who he is as the Son of God is proclaimed and known. It is for us to reclaim Christmas so that our lives live out of the love of God in our hearts. So I'd ask you, who's Jesus for you? And what difference does knowing him make in your life? The world needs us to know Jesus. And it needs us to allow him to change our lives. We had some fun. We had St. Nicholas visit us today. Ha! Now, we can dress. Drew voluntarily dressed himself up as St. Nick. But how, so we can see him as St. Nick, but how about seeing ourselves as St. Nick? You and I as St. Nick. Let's see more. Any more? Oh, there are more. Let's own who we are. We're not St. Nick, but we're St. Carolyn and St. Brian. We are the saints of the church. We are the light of the world. And as we reclaim Christmas, let's reclaim who we are and live from the depth of our truth as Jesus calls us to live. Amen. And amen.